Introduced with Corpus Railjack were two special weapon mods, Internal Bleeding and Hemorrhage, for rifles and secondaries respectively. These mods give you a chance to apply a slash status effect when the weapon deals an impact status effect, with double the likelihood if the weapon has a low fire rate. The question today then is, are those mods actually viable? I'm the Engineer, let's solve a practical problem. The impact status effect is one of the least desired in all of Warframe, while slash status is one of the most desired. It makes some kind of sense then to want to trade impact for slash as a way of dealing more damage. These mods have a similar effect to Hunt Munitions, a primary mod which can apply slash status on critical hits, with the key difference coming down to procing off impact status instead of criticals. As there is no Hunt Munitions for secondaries, we'll start a comparison with them. In terms of damage over time effects, slash is actually the weakest for raw damage out of all status effects. What makes it desirable at all is that it skips armor entirely, potentially dealing more damage per tick than the initial hit that caused the proc to happen. Compared to slash, the next best means of dealing damage over time to armored enemies would be with a heat proc. It just so happens that secondaries can use primed heated charge, a 16 drain mod which makes for a solid competitor to Hemorrhage for this comparison. For the rest of the mod slots on a secondary, 5 of those slots will fall to so-called mandatory mods due to their power. With the exception of the effects of viral modding, the other options you'd usually want to use on any worthwhile secondary don't change the balance between primed heated charge and Hemorrhage, so we don't need to worry ourselves with those. All we need to consider are the heat or slash procs we can mod in, with or without viral. Using primed heated charge without other elemental modifiers, you can expect a heat proc for 62.3% of all the procs the weapon applies under normal circumstances. The damage this heat proc will do every second will be 1.325 times the modded damage of the weapon, before target modifiers and armor come into play, of course. Multiplying these two values together, we get a score of 0.825. This represents how effective we can expect the proc to be without needing to consider the weapon's status chance or damage stats. This is true for basically all secondaries, and certainly the ones we'll consider using today. With Hemorrhage equipped instead of primed heated charge, the amount of slash procs dealt varies based on the fire rate of the weapon, and also based on what portion of the weapon's impact, puncture and slash, or IPS for short, is made of impact damage. For faster firing secondaries, Hemorrhage will proc 35% of the time upon landing an impact status effect, and then the damage per second dealt by this proc is 0.35 times the modded damage of the weapon. For faster firing weapons with pure impact damage only, which for secondaries is only the initial impact of some explosive weaponry, this would give a score of 0.123. If the weapon has any lower proportion of impact than 100%, the score comes down accordingly, to 0.061 at 50% impact, and just 0.012 at 10% impact. If the weapon has a fire rate under 2.5, the number of slash procs, and therefore the overall score, doubles. So comparing the score for heat of 0.825 to the scores for impact, we can calculate how much armor a target needs in order to take more actual DPS from the slash procs than they do from the heat procs over time, both for slower and faster firing secondaries. While enemy armor varies quite wildly due to levels, difficulty modifiers and unit type, we can approximate the typical Grenier armor on the seal path to be about 6,000. Many units will be above and below this value, but I've chosen 6,000 as that's a little under elite lancers at steel path level 105, and a little over that of troopers until about steel path level 125. So this covers the typical Grenier infantry unit. What this means is that at steel path tiers, in order for Hemorrhage to be more useful than primed heated charge in dealing damage, and that's without using a viral build, faster firing weapons would need to have at least 60% impact, while slower firing weapons, which get below 2.5 fire rate, would just need at least 30% impact at base. So far, so good. There are plenty of weapons that have 30% or more impact. However, running without viral in a status capable weapon is usually a bad idea, and this case is no different. A non-viral setup would look to get most damage from using mods like Anemic Agility and Augur Pact, assuming you don't have a Riven. while swapping to Frostbite and Pistol Pestilence, loses that base damage and fire rate, the effects of the increased status chance, viral elemental damage, and viral procs more than offset the difference. For the Hemorrhage setup, the addition of 60-60 mods for viral doesn't mean that impact is procced any more often per shot than before. Instead, the viral procs will increase our slash proc damage from the converted impact procs. On the other hand, due to the considerable amount of heat being added by Primed Heater Charge to its build, the number of heat procs per shot actually increases in addition to the damage increasing. This causes the DPS from heat procs in the heat build to increase despite the reduction by fire rate and base damage by modding for viral. Ultimately, this means that Hemorrhage falls behind. The full effect of this is that the Hemorrhage slash procs, even with 100% impact and a slow fire rate, would still be weaker than heat procs even onto the steel path. As heat also does 25% more damage to Grenier health by default, using any normal secondary weapon to try and proc impact for Hemorrhage is outright worse than relying on using heat for status damage. There is a way to get around this situation though. A limited selection of weapons have 4 status effects on hit, which bypasses the need for status chance. For secondary weapons, the most notable for this is the Epitaph, introduced with Sevagoth. The direct hit from Epitaph's charge shot deals a guaranteed impact proc. What's more, Epitaph has unusually high critical and damage stats on this charge shot. Combining this with uncharged shots to spread viral status, this is a particularly potent combination. The only other secondary which has forced impact procs on its main damage is the Catch Moon kit gun, although that weapon is limited to a very short 9m range for those guaranteed procs. So while the Catch Moon can use Hemorrhage somewhat effectively, the only secondary in the game I'd recommend using this mod on is the Epitaph. The combination of high damage and high critical stats, as well as getting around the status problem, makes it the only one viable. Moving on to primary weapons, we have the counterpart mod Internal Bleeding. Stats-wise, it is identical to Hemorrhage. However, competition-wise, things are different. The Primed Elemental mod for rifles is for cold damage rather than heat, which doesn't deal a damaging proc. So the next best elemental contender comes from the standard Hellfire mod. Because Hellfire is that much weaker than Primed Heated Charge, Internal Bleeding has a little more room to be competitive on the steel path. As it turns out, if you're using a viral build, Internal Bleeding is more effective than Hellfire if you have 100% impact on a high fire rate weapon, or 50% impact on weapons with under 2.5 fire rate. Except, Hellfire isn't the only competition against Internal Bleeding. Remember I mentioned earlier the mod Hunter Munitions? Almost any weapon worth its salt in the damage dealing department will have a high critical chance. And that's because critical damage multipliers are just that good. Even if you're using a weapon with a low critical chance, but then stacking things like Arcane Avenger for the flat critical chance buff, you're still using effectively a critical based weapon, just with extra steps. For any such weapon, Hunter Munitions is far more reliable when it comes to dealing with high armor targets. Due to its scaling off crits instead of status, you do not need to spend time modding for impact status at all. You can either mod for viral at that stage, or get your viral from abilities and companions, and just go full damage on the primary weapon. In this way, Hunter Munitions outscales Internal Bleeding for almost all circumstances, by sheer virtue of not demanding status chance on top of everything else. So that's a damning result for Internal Bleeding, but there is a use case to be salvaged still. Just like with Hemorrhage, Internal Bleeding finds a footing with those few weapons which, once again, are able to deal forced impact procs on their main damage. Those key weapons are the Daikyu, Fulmin, Kuvachaka, Nagantaka, and Quellor. The Fulmin still suffers from a 9m range on the guaranteed impact procs in semi-auto mode, just like with the Catch Moon secondary. But the low fire rate means it can still make solid use of Internal Bleeding for that 70% chance of procking slash. That 70% is much higher than the maximum 30% from Hunter Munitions, albeit in a limited range. Likewise, the Quellor is limited to an 18m range on its ult fires, forced impact procs. But again, with its low enough fire rate, it really benefits from Internal Bleeding. The Nagantaka, Kuvachaka, and Daikyu have known range restrictions on their forced impact procs, allowing you to pick your range much more favourably. While some of these aren't the most meta weapons in themselves, internal bleeding allows them to keep up with the ever-scaling armour some enemies possess. For every other primary weapon though, internal bleeding just simply isn't effective enough. For both Hemorrhage and internal bleeding, they're utilising slash procs, which means faction damage buffs will allow you to achieve significantly more damage. When you're able to, subsuming Rhino's Roar onto your Warframe, or have an ally bring Roar, will be an incredible boost to your overall output with these mods, just like with any other status damage build. However, if you are using a weapon which is relying on that lower fire rate to proc these mods more often, be aware that any buff to your fire rate which brings you over the 2.5 threshold will halve your slash output per shot. This is especially important for less ammo efficient weaponry. So just watch out for buffs like Wisp's Haste Mote, lest it break your build. So there you have it, the practical reality of the two impact trading mods. For secondaries and primaries alike, if the weapon doesn't have a forced impact proc on its main damage, the mods simply aren't worth it. But for those 7 weapons which do have usable impact procs, these mods can give you a new way of carving through highly armoured targets. That said, these are not suited to unarmoured enemies like most Corpus and Infested, or status resistant enemies like Sentients and Acolytes. The majority of builds currently using Hunter Munitions will not see any benefit from switching over. If you have found this video helpful, give it a like, and subscribe to get notified as I upload more. Remember as well, you can catch more from myself live over at twitch.tv/thekengineer to discuss builds, farm missions, and overall just sharing this game we all love. That's all from me though, so as always, Force Impact, Proc Slash, and Fight Well, Tenno.